Hello everybody, I'm Pier Luca Lanzi. I'm from the Politecnico di Milano, where I teach data mining and text mining, and also video game design and programming. I'm going to give you a short introduction to game design. It will be a rather short introduction. It won't be technical, but the idea is to understand what is game design, what are the principles that govern game design. So, the title of my presentation is kind of weird, but I will tell you, I will explain it immediately. So, now we'll ask you to make an exercise. It's actually the exercise that starts one of the most important books in game design, that is The Art of Game Design, A Book of Lenses by Shell. And it's just to say what was contained in the title. So what I would like you to do when the sign appears is to read it out loud, okay? Don't be afraid. It's not a... There is not something weird, but just say this.
I am a game
designer. Okay, that's perfect. So the question is, why did I ask you to say this? I'm not a game designer. You are not probably a game designer. But I just ask you to say, I am a game designer. So we are basically faking that we are game designers. I didn't say that you are an engineer, because probably you're not yet, but I just said this. So the reasons is twofold. First, even if you don't know, in a way, you are a game designer. You forgot you have been a game designer. Because when we were kids, we invented games almost every day, okay? And if you have nephews and kids around, it's typical. You teach them to play chess, and they say, no, no, let's not play this way, but I can tell you how to play it, and there is another way to play it, okay? And if you see kids, I remember once upon a time I was waiting for a table in a pizzeria, and outside the door there were two kids completely playing with some weird stuff on the floor. It was really dirty, but they enjoyed themselves. The parents were completely bored because they were to wait 20 minutes in queue, and it was like this. And the kids were enjoying themselves on the floor, inventing a game, and there was no idea what the game was. The second reason is that, and it's actually how the book starts, is that you have to reassure yourself, you have to give yourself confidence, because actually game design is kind of an undefined title, okay? So you are a game designer if you make games, and it's actually, there is a mantra at the beginning of the book where it says, every morning I say to myself, I look at myself in the mirror and I say, I am a game designer. And then he said, what you are, I am a game designer. So he can reassure himself, he is a game designer. So who is a game designer? So in a way, you may say, it's a guy that designs games.
So, all right, what's going on, ladies and gentlemen? My name is Touch Ninja, and I'm welcoming you to my walkthrough of New
Super Mario Bros. It's a guy that designed something like this, and I see this, and I say, this is a very nice game.
We get to play
look at the mushrooms, they are really nice.
It's been such a long time
This
coming.
Is
I can't wait until we get to play Zelda in
Mario.
But so I think Mario is
you decide
a good launch
what
title.
Kind of story
yeah,
mode you want. You decide.
Hopefully you guys are going to enjoy the series. As always, if you guys are going to enjoy the series, please give this first video the
I'm
biggest
trying to
that you can.
Push it. Then at some point you have your, you know, your stuff. You do your stuff. Sweet. You have your levels. You have coins.
Familiar sound. The controls are pretty good, even though it's taking
it's
a bit
actually,
to the game, the joystick side.
You can
like
take,
failure.
Do this
but
weird stuff.
Controls are good.
And stuff like this. So
sounds
these
good.
Are games, and so game designers, in a way, work on this stuff. Okay. And actually, they work in several different ways. Depending on the game, they can do the design of the game overall. They can work on music. They can work on the story. They can work on the mechanics. They can work on several stuff.
there's no way to...
It's important to note that ourselves, when we look at a game, we look at the aesthetic part of the game, then we try it, we see that whether we like to play, we like to play it.
Without jumping.
And that's it. So, in a way, one of the theory underlying game design, that is the MDA model, it basically says that the player looks first at the aesthetic. It looks at Mario. It's very nice, Mario, right? If it was cubes moving around, well, maybe yes, maybe no. Then it plays. It does something. It activates some dynamics. And basically, only if it really plays a lot, it discovers the underlying secrets of the games, and it discovers the underlying mechanics. On the other hand, a game designer just does the other way around. It basically starts from the mechanics, then it tries to implement some dynamics, and then also it works on the aesthetic, but the core of the games, they are the core mechanics. Okay? And it's another way to look at that. What are the mechanics? So, typically, when you play a game and you have to play chess, you say, what are the rules of the game? Okay, and the what you call the game rules are basically what is printed at what the player knows and is aware of. So the game mechanics per se, it's a very important part, and it's basically the overall product of the rules, the processes that are activated by the interaction between the rules and the players, the data underlying the game, it's the whole bunch of stuff, okay? And it's basically also the game mechanics define how the player progress, what happens when, what is needed to win, etc., etc. So the game mechanics are something that is the heart of the game, and that's where the game designer works, okay? They are really important because at the end of the day, for instance, you see this one, you say, oh, that's a very nice game. It's really successful. I wish I would have designed this one because probably I would be very rich and not here right now, but somewhere on the beach. You look at this game and you say, this game is really new. It's invention, great invention, great invention. Great invention, I won't say the bad word, but it's basically a copy of a game that existed when I was a kid. It's exactly the same copy. The mechanics are also the same, okay? The only thing that was added here with respect to that one was these bonuses, okay? The value of the letters, but they are basically inherited by all the games you can imagine between Scrabble and stuff like this. And also these ones are from Scrabble, from the table paper Scrabble, okay? And also the thing here. Actually, there was a two minutes timer, but it was made by hand. But basically, the mechanics of these two games are basically the same, okay? Obviously, here you exploit some technological stuff that allows me to play with a Italian guy that is 2,000 kilometers from here, but I can really play with him. Here I could only play with my friends. But basically, the mechanics underlying those are basically the same, okay? And actually, there is a nice, in a very important book about game design, that is The Theory of Fun for Game Designer, A Theory of Fun for Game Designer, the Ralph Koster. There is a whole discussion where it shows that most of the games that you know as 2D shooters, like Space Invaders, but Galaga and other stuff, they are all a derivation, an extension from some very few initial concepts. So, for instance, you start from Space War, that is the first game ever made with a computer. And then you have Space Invaders, and Space War is basically a spaceship in the center that is shooting to an adversary while is also trying to avoid a black hole. Then you put the spaceship at the bottom and you shoot at the top, you get Space Invaders. And then you introduce asteroids and you eliminate the black hole and you have asteroids. And then if you shoot, take Space Invaders, there are stuff there. And then they walk like this. Then suddenly you say, okay, that made them fly weirdly. And then you have Galaxian, then you have Galaga, etc., etc., etc. Actually, even Centipede, it's taken from, it can be seen as the same mechanics of Galaxian. So the mechanics are very important because when a game designer looks at the game, he doesn't look at the, from the aesthetic part, but he looks at the core of the game. And actually, it's very frustrating from time to time because you get bored really soon from playing games when you try to look at games like this. In the middle, there is something that are the dynamics. And the dynamics is something that you can introduce to give a certain flavor to the game. So, for instance, if you play Mario Kart, Mario Kart is engineered not to make you win until the very last minute. So, typically, you're running around with your, even if you're playing alone with all the artificial intelligence, typically, you are always surrounded by NPC, non-player characters, or the other guys. And typically, they are trying to bounce you out, etc., etc. There is no way that you can do what you might be able to do, for instance, for with the simulation car racing like F1, that if you play with friends, with like somebody that cannot run an F1 like me, you start the race and you are making most of the race alone. So you have your own advantages, et cetera, et cetera. Here, it has been decided that it's very interesting for you to keep you in the game, as we are going to see in flow. What is very important to do is to give you opponents that are continually trying to make you feel that you are almost there, almost there, almost there. Then sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. And this is a very important issue in gaming. The best game possible, you might argue that, you might think that it's a very good game if the player is very happy because he wins a lot, okay? But it's not like this, because if you win too much, you get bored. So there is no way that's the good approach. The good approach is sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. But when you lose, you always think or feel, have the feeling that you miss it for a little bit. You know, you were not completely a screw up and you really lose the game in a very weird way, etc., etc. But actually, you know, you're playing cards like a Briscola or whatever card game you have. Yeah, I lost. But actually, I lost, you know, because the last card I pick up, it was not the right card. But because if that was a king, I would have won. Okay? So any game that is keeping you really tight into the balance between victory and loss, and make you feel that if you lose, it was your fault, but actually also luck. That's the best game possible, and this is the dynamics that this one, game like this, implement. Okay. Now, if we want to analyze games, what we need to do? Well, we need to do two things. Well, we need to understand games, and we need to look at games in a different way. And basically what we need to do is to build up a dictionary to speak about games and to understand what are the elements that make a game. So the question is, oh my God, really? So you take games and video games, and you give them to a university professor, and suddenly he starts to make definitions and stuff like that, to make them really, really boring, which is okay. Actually, there have actually been the game designers themselves that tried to give the definitions, and the advantage of giving a definition is to identify those elements. And then when you have to design a game, you can work on those elements and identify those elements, and those elements becomes the leverage you have to produce something new, okay? So, first of all, we're going to look at the structure of the games. And then, after we are looking at structure of games, we're going to go around and say how we can use those to make an interesting game. Okay? In Italian, this doesn't go well, but if you think about video games, and you ask yourself, what is a video game? Well, it's basically a compound of two words, video plus games. And actually, then video, what's video there? Well, if you consider the other games, card games, board games, the adjective is just the mean we use. So video games, board games, and card games, they are all games, and they have a different medium. So basically, from this, I should be able to say that if I take all the games, all the possible games, they all should share the same elements. So in my way to say, give definitions, I should be able to identify the same elements all around here. So another game design book typically starts with the Doom and chess, but here I put four for the fun, and says, okay, look at the similarities and look at the differences. Okay, this could be very interactive, but you are way too many to make this. So I ask you just to think 30 seconds. Think about any card game you know, any board game you know, whatever video game you played, and think about the similarities between those games and the differences between those games, okay? Now, so what are the similarities and differences in this case? So if I think about these four games, there is one thing that is always there, and it's the most important thing present in a game. Can somebody guess who is it? What is it? What's that? Rules? Other thing? The enemy? Other thing? Win or lose state? What's that? Ah, playground. Okay, playground. Okay. Plot? Goal? Oh, that's very interesting because, okay, the most important part, and it's, was that? Sorry, I'm deaf from one ear. Fun? Player. That's the most important part. Everybody forgets about the player. And it's very, very, very important. Why it is important? It's written there somewhere. You cannot command somebody to play. I can say to somebody, study, okay? I can say, walk. I cannot say, play, okay? I cannot force anybody to play. And actually, if you tried when you were a kid and you tried to say, no, I want to play, come on, play. And the other guy say, no, I really don't want to play. And you force him to play, force him or her to play, then they are playing really not really motivated. Then you become angry because you say, why are not you're not playing, you're not putting your best effort in that? Because I don't want to play, okay? So that's something that you cannot force. The player must have the attitude to play. Otherwise, he cannot play. And the important part is that when you ask to somebody to be a player, the player that must voluntarily accept the rules and the constraints of the game, okay? So if you ask me, do you want to play chess? Yes, I sit at the table and I start playing with this weird rules or randomly, or I play without that. You don't accept that. And that's the most important question, because I don't know whether you or not you're going to try to make a game in this career, in this course, etc. But the most important part, and that's very interesting, in my experience, because I had experience also with ASP students and master students and other people that asked me for help in making their games, The most fundamental question is why somebody should wish to play your game. Okay, why I should do it? Okay, and I heard a weird proposal that you know on paper they would be amazing. Like yes, let's build a one from ASP students was really I criticized heavily. It was something like. We wish to build a sim city based on the Martesana. The people from the Lombardia, they know it's a park in Milan. And I said, why should I play it? Because Martesana is a very nice park, et cetera, et cetera. And my question was, okay, did you ever play sim city in Paris? And they said, yes. I said, really? Can you show me, we can go online, can you show me the package, the picture of the game, SimCity Paris? And they, obviously there is no SimCity Paris. Why? Because basically when you want to play SimCity, you don't want to be in a certain place, but you want to be in a fictional place, and that makes the game interesting. So first of all, I would never play Martesana SimCity, Martesana Sim something. But not even Udine, that is my hometown, or whatever else. Okay, so really, you must be really able to answer this question, because otherwise, there is no game without the player. And the important part is that you must convince, and the player, it's not that you must convince the players, but you must really have them accept the whole package. Then somebody said goal somewhere there, and actually, yes, you have to give objectives. You have to give objectives, and you have to give some specific objectives or goals, okay? It's really interesting about players, sorry, I go back to players because I forgot about something, that you can force somebody to listen to music. I can make here, I can put up one of the recent David Bowie songs that were listening when coming here, and I can force you to listen to that, even if you don't want to. I put it in a very low volume and I can force you. So I can force you to do something with music. I cannot do it with games. That's make games special. Objectives are very important. Can you have a game without objectives? Generally, no. But recently, somebody made a game with no objectives at all, and everybody was really curious to try it. Okay, it was you roam around in a forest, and from in a forest you would go to some parts, and there were some kind of music, and then there were people going around. It's actually on PS3, I think. It was is going to be published on PS3. There are activities that are not that don't have a goal, so I can watch a movie just because I have time to pass, or I want to stay on my couch. But that's in games, the objectives are key elements. Okay. That gives structure and actually also gives a kind of meaning to that, okay? The fact that I want to, that the player wants to achieve the objective also makes, gives a measure of the involvement of the player. If I don't want to win my chess play, my chess match, it's actually my objective is not interesting. If I want to beat somebody at win the card play, that's a totally different thing. There are two things that are present in a game, that are rules and procedure. The difference is very subtle. The rules are the typical thing. In chess, the king can move in this way, and you lose if blah blah blah. Procedure are everything that comes before and the organization of the match. Okay, so it's typically you choose the color of your pieces and. For instance, in chess, you take the two elements and you say, you mix and you say left or right, and then I say, oh, you took white, and then we rotate the board, et cetera, et cetera. And sometimes the procedure is very important because the procedure is also the part that in the game makes you move from us here into the actual game, into our fictional world, okay? I cannot have it here, but for instance, one of the best procedure in the world of gaming, it's Guitar Hero. because when you put up yourself, you are in front of the TV and you put on the guitar, that is a very crappy guitar, and you start and you have the guitar there, it's really a fake guitar. It has only four buttons. It's really, really, really bad. But actually you feel like Aerosmith all over again, okay? And that's a very important process. That's the whole process, the part of the procedure implements what is called the onboarding, okay? The player that leaves the real world and enters the fictional world of gaming, where he wants to stay for a certain time. Most of the game have resources. Chess, it's the number of pieces you have, for instance. There are several games that are there are several games that are based on resources. If you played something like StarCraft, Warcraft, even World of Warcraft. In several games, resources are a major key. And actually, just to give you an example, there was a game designer that was speaking at one of our lectures, and he was making an example of use of resources to create the pace of a game. So, now, suppose that you have a shooter game, an FPS, where the one that you are in first person and you go around and shoot stuff, okay? Whatever are, the zombies, aliens, companions, professors, whatever it is. The question is, you can actually, what are the resources there? There are the weapons and actually the ammos, okay, the ammunitions. So you can create a completely different feeling in the game by working on the resources. So two examples. There is a game that is called It Lead, or you can also try to something like Postal, one, Postal 2, 3, whatever, where you have the goal is to kill everybody. So basically you have ammos and weapons all around and you can shoot whatever. And the pace you create in the game, it's extremely high-paced. And you feel like, yes, let's go shooting, all happy and go around, okay? On the other hand, if you take Resident Evil 5, that was the one in Africa, which was highly criticized because actually most of the zombies were blacks, so it was not really nice, a group of five whites that goes and kill all the black zombies. There was a different decision, a completely different decision, that the ammos were completely scarce. So if you play it, you always feel that, oh, somebody's coming, I have to shoot. But, oh my God, I have only 5 bullets. If I don't take the first time, then I'm not sure that the second times will go well. And you always feel this pressure to scarcity of resources. So you can work on something like this to completely change your feeling of the game. What rules, resources, goals, etc. bring and build, it's the conflict. And that's actually really the goal of the game. The goal of a game for the player is to solve the conflict that the game builds. What is the conflict? Well, it's actually something that is, it is there because I have a goal and I made rules that actually don't allow me to get to the goal, to achieve the goal easily. And the typical example, every designer does this example, I don't know why there is no other examples, it's actually golf. Let's take golf as an example of game. So the goal of the game, well, you have the player and you have to convince them to pay a lot of money to go and play golf. If they have them, then they go there, you give them the goal. And you give the goal that is take the ball into the hole, okay? So it's a very plain and simple goal. So if there were no rules, I would take the ball, walk to the hole and put my there. So I decide it's too easy, so I decide to bring sticks there. And I have to say, okay, I put it far, 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 far away. You cannot touch the ball. You have only to use sticks. And then you have to put the ball there. And so that's how I create conflict. My conflict is I wish to take the ball into the hole, but the rules don't allow me to use the easiest solution out. So I create this conflict, and this conflict is very important, because if the conflict is not acceptable, then people won't play the game. So suppose that I make the version of the toothpick golf, where you have to use a toothpick to put the ball. Stuzzicadente, for the one who didn't understand. So would anybody play golf with a toothpick? No. Would everybody play golf, I don't know, with a cannon? You have to shoot the ball with a cannon and put it there? Not really. So I have to have the right balance, and if the conflict is acceptable, then the player accepts to play the game, and that's everything is in work. Okay? The other thing that it's important in the game, it's the outcome. Why it is important? Well, it's important that the outcome is unknown, and it's kind of random. I mean, not random completely, but it's uncertain. Because otherwise, it's not really a game you wish to play. So the typical example I do in this case, it's suppose there is a student of mine who is a master in, it's a math engineering student, and it's a chess master. National chess master, is not like an international chess master, but it's a chess master. I barely know how to move the pieces, okay? Would I play chess with him? No, because I already know that he will beat me, okay? Maybe I can ask him to teach me chess, but I wouldn't play chess with him, because he would be the guy that I move, the second piece I move. Okay, this is checkmate in 37 moves, and I say, oh my God, where I'm going to do? Okay, so would it be nice? No, because it's not uncertain. Actually, it cannot be completely random, because otherwise you wouldn't play. So, as I said before, there must be this balance where you feel that it's uncertain, you can win, but at the same time, and you're always in balance until the end, okay? So, Mario Kart does it by putting, programming, artificial intelligence, say, that's the player, go around the player. So you are the player and you're always surrounded by people that are trying to kick you out. Razzles does the same. Who plays Razzle? Oh, come on, do some outing. Say I play Razzle. Okay, how does Razzle implement this idea of having uncertainty? There are two things that does. Come on, some volunteer to say. That's the best, I don't know why, you attended my course before? No, that's a very good answer. That's the, when you play Razzle, the first match you play, but the difference, even if I play with my girlfriend, that she's very good with respect to me, that I'm completely scarce. The difference could be 50, 60 points, 100 points, and I said, oh my God. But the second time I played in the second match, there are three matches in Razzle, right? So the first match, usually distribute a little bit of points, a small amount of points. The second match, a little bit more, okay? You always arrive at the third match, where basically, you have the feeling that you can do it, okay? You still have the feeling, rarely you say, no, I cannot do it, it's 100 points. You say something that's something like 60, 100 points, 200 points over 1,000. You say, it's 10%, I can do it, and typically you don't. So the point is that you have the feeling to play the third match. Few people, I mean, at least, I'm very scarce at Razzle, but I never had the feeling that I don't play this match because you already won, okay? My adversary, my opponent is too strong, I already won. The second factor that does this, it is the matchup between opponents, okay? Razzles and other games, they have all, especially the multiplayer games, all the multiplayer games, they have algorithms that must be very, very good to match you up with an opponent that is typically at your level or reachable level. Because otherwise, if hypothetically it would put you always against something that is too strong for you, you would leave RASL and the RASL community immediately, and they don't want that. Now, all of what they have seen are called formal elements, and basically they are the essence of the game. They are the essence of games. And what the designer does is to put everything there, use this, work on this, and in a way use them to make some outstanding or it uses as leverage to make a new form of games, etc. Okay? The point here is that by understanding that you have all these elements, you may say, okay, what about a game that doesn't have competition? Can I create a game with where six people that can collaborate together and can also enjoy playing? Question. Did you ever play a game like that? Dungeons and Dragons, that's a very good option, yes. Dungeons and Dragons, that's a role-playing game. Other? The Sims, it's a kind of, it's not collaborative, really. Dungeons and Dragons, it's a good option if your guild is, it's okay, I mean, it has a uniform mixing, because if you play, if you are, I don't know, like I was a paladin, and you find yourself with the chaotic evil in your group, then let's say that the work together is not really nice. Sim, it's interesting because you don't have to fight, but actually you have a sort of competition for resources, etc., etc. Others? What's that? Splinter Cell, but it's always when team one with team two or against something, right? That's interesting because it's collaborative at one level, but it's competitive with the other level. So it's typically, do you know the episode of the funeral party? It's a very interesting part where you have a guild that was attending a funeral, that was a fake funeral for somebody who was already dead, really in the real life. And basically another guild go there and kill them all. So it's collaborative at some point. Minecraft is difficult because it's not really collaborative, you play alone. There is one other thing, is that one of the milestones is the Lord of the Rings, the table game, which was the first table game that was completely collaborative. There are other games that are collaborative, but one of the best games I've seen, it is this one. And I advise you to play this. It is called Space Team. The idea is very simple.
This is your captain speaking.
These are the guys, the
incoherent shouting.
So the idea is very simple. You are all members of the space team in an astronaut, and everybody, it's free, so you can download it. Everybody has his own part of commands, you can do it. Okay, so everybody has a part of the deck, okay, like phaser and barrier and engines and stuff like this. And every time there comes something like barriers on, fire the torpedo, but you don't know whether you have the torpedo, so you read fire the torpedo, you look at if you have fire the torpedo, if you don't have it, you have to shout fire the torpedo, because the other guy that could have the torpedo should fire it. And so, you see here, increase, I don't remember what, to one. So you, so everybody is collaborating, and everybody lose when the ship goes down because it crashes. So that's when, you know, everybody has to, it's a very nice party game. It's a very nice party game. You should try it because it's really, it's free, and it's an amazing game. It's very recent. Originally, I wanted to make you try this one here. But actually, it would have been difficult with so many people to try it because you have to look at the screen. But it's very, very nice. It's very, very nice to try. There are competitive games that are really, really weird. And this is from the Copenhagen Game Collective. It's called Joust. It's basically using the move. One against the other. And basically you have to put the adversary opponent in out of balance. Here you have, basically you have music, and you have the music tempo, and you have to move at the music tempo with the move, and the other guy have to shook you and to move you. So you have something that is computerized, because there is a computer, but you don't have the computer there. You don't have a screen. So basically you are defending your stuff while others try to move it. And it's interesting that because you have the same, well, you can download it, it's in this one. You have to buy the Sony moves. Depending on the tempo, you have to keep the tempo. You cannot move outside the tempo, otherwise you lose, okay? So the other ones, when it goes slow, everybody's going slow, but they are trying to move. But I cannot move somebody else by moving mine, because otherwise I lose. And it's very nice. Always by the Copenhagen Game Collective, they are an experimental gameplay group. Button is amazing, it's an amazing game. So Button works like this. You have a computer with controllers, like controllers for the Xbox there, and there are all the buttons there. So you have instructions like take, fake, by index. And then the rules are given by the computer, but actually implemented by the guys that says, no, you didn't do the right thing. So the rules are not implemented by the guy. So move slowly, 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 and then you have to push it. And then you can actually try to combat the other player, not to allowing. It's a very nice party game, you can download it too. And so there are different games you can play with that. 5 push-ups and then take that one, jump, 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 and then go. You have to drink a beer and then... These are from the ITU. It's an institute about media, and they have a very nice part. And that's another way to see a game, right? And it's all about working on the elements and try to use the right leverage, right? So what about a game without this? Or what about a game without rules? Or what about a game, et cetera, et cetera? The interesting part is that at some point, you might build up a game with the same core mechanics that is basically successful or completely unsuccessful. And you go, for instance, from here. It's called Frag. Fragger, sorry. So you have terrorists, you drop bombs on terrorists, they explode, you get points. It's really nice, you know? You know, basically mail should be all, let's go and combat terrorists. So it should be very, very, yes, very nice puzzles to solve. Levels, etc., etc., and it's a very nice game. But actually, it was not as successful
as
this one.
What's up? Jonathan,
and actually, the core mechanics
today
are exactly the same. And actually, if you see it on paper, you say, "I have a game where you have to kill terrorists, and I have a game where you have birds that suicide themselves by exploding near green peaks."
I hope you guys enjoyed this review of Angry Birds.
And actually,
really fun and interesting
if you
game.
Check out Angry Birds, the story, it's interesting so because it also has the story at the beginning. If you think the story,
launch the
story is you have to kill the green pigs. Why?
I wanted to
we stole
say
the
that
eggs. The do you ever see the eggs
cool.
all around in the game?
Has a lot of
no.
hours of
so,
gameplay.
So what?
99 cents
you know,
is pretty cheap.
It's really weird
game,
because the goal
opinion.
Is not even there. It's like playing golf without
the
hole somewhere.
On this menu. The information, I'm just going to tell you a little bit of information.
So the question is, what makes
application.
One game successful or the other? Nobody knows, obviously.
You can hear in the background. Just mute that if you'd like. Turn it back on.
But there are elements you can work on to make it work. So one of the things that is very important is the challenge. So the level of challenge you give to your players, okay? So the conflict that we created by putting rules and putting a goal that is basically opposed to the is some kind of blocked by the rules. The conflict challenges the player. So the idea is that since I have this conflict, since I have to bring the ball, to put the ball in the hole somewhere down there, it creates tension because I want to do it. And then it creates achievement or frustration, okay? So if I play chess with a champion, a master, then I have a certain type of frustration, for instance. If you increase the challenge, you increase the tension, but actually too much challenge causes frustration and the guy goes away. Okay, so for instance, I played a game from an Italian company, it's a version of the Hangman game, and they started with the very difficult words, okay, Italian words, but it was incredible. I had to check out on the dictionary what they mean, so it was really, really difficult word. I immediately drop it, because actually, you cannot give me in the first level, first screen, once something that is too difficult, okay? And so that's very important, the balance between the right level of challenge and the right and the acceptable frustration you can get. There is also the premise that's very important. So in a way, World of Warcraft puts me in a fantasy world when I have to become a bright knight and I can level up and become a powerful a powerful character in the world. Sometimes I might not like some of the goals. So for instance, in Monopoly, the goal of Monopoly is to bankrupt the opponent. Do I like it? If I like it, I might play it. If I don't like it, I might not play. Do you know any game where you have to kill puppies? No, because probably nobody would play it, right? Now, the important part in these two elements, the premise is very important, but actually you can easily solve it. The problem about the major problem is about the challenge. And everything comes out by Mihai Csikszentmihalyi, that's a positive psychologist, who made a study from the 60s, and he basically said, oh, sorry, I cut and paste the wrong one, the one that is in, that one is in Italian, my bad. That basically interviewed people, sportsmen, players, whatever, businessmen, and he basically interviewed them about that very moment when you are working, where you basically forget about anything else. You are in the work, you are completely doing some stuff. It could be play, but it could be when you are writing a part of your thesis, or you are doing an exercise, or you are doing some stuff. Suddenly you forget about something, anything, sorry. So suddenly time goes by as it was, you know, you really feel there, okay? And that's called flow. And the flow, so it interviewed all these people, it analyzed all the answers of that, and basically, he identifies some of the factors that contribute to take you inside this area that is the most positive area. Okay, when you feel good doing some stuff, okay, you feel challenged, but still you feel that you can do it, so you can really you're really into that, and that's a very very good moment, even if you do sports or if you play. And two of the things that more influence this stuff. Your presence in flow is given by your skill level that you are required to do the task, and your skill level, sorry, your own skill level and the skill level you are required to do the task. So, for instance, if I'm very good at some stuff, I'm very good, okay, but the game doesn't challenge me at all, and I'm here, I get bored very easily. So if I get bored, I leave. On the other hand, like playing against a chess master, my skills are almost null in chess. I play a chess master, I'm here, and basically I'm frustrated. This is the area of frustration. So in the middle, it's what I want to stay, okay? And so you have to balance these two elements just to allow the player to stay there. Other elements where you work can, you can use that, but as I say, flow is the most important one, is the character. So if you have characters in your, inside your game, you can work on that. And Mario was very, very, very successful in that. You can have a story. You can work on a story and have a nice storyline that takes the character, take the player inside there and in, basically makes him or her relate to the game. Typical example of this is Heavy Rain, that is a PS3 game that was the first one to move to make something that was more like a movie with a big story. One of the most recent games that is has been prized about the story. It is The Last of Us. It's also a PS3 game. It's very well known for the type of character it depicts and how the story is, let's say, complex and...
Do I need to remind you what is out there?
Once upon a time, there are always kind of zombies around, but you are, you know,
that I cared
this,
about.
This is the mood of scarcity, etc.
In this world, that sort of shit's good for one thing. Getting you killed.
It's interesting that whether you have a story or not, typically everything follows. It's the most thing, the most important thing that is used is the narrative curve, where every part, even if you are using a story or not, even Pac-Man or even Super Mario works like this. That you have an exposition of the challenge, okay, you have to do this. Then you have to face some difficulties. The action becomes more and more difficult. At some point, it reaches a climax. In 2D shooters, it's typically the boss fight, where you have you are fighting small ships, and suddenly kill all the small ships, and suddenly a bigger ship comes. Or, it's, for instance, in stories, you can have a major issue to solve, and then suddenly, everything is solved, and then there is a relaxation period. Typically, in Super Mario, when you finish a level that at the end is very difficult, then you have money, ding, 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 everything that comes up, music, dancing, etc., etc. Pac-Man had the same, and then you have your resolution. Every level typically is done like this. So if you put them all together, what you have. You have that the flow of the game is something like this. You go from onboarding, I decide to play. I have the first climb for playing from the exposition of the story, the climax, then I rest. Then second level, rest. Third level, there could be some big fight here, rest, etc., etc. So it's a stepwise thing. Now, another element you can work on is to understand who are your players. And this is a classification, very famous classification of players. So, and the classification is based on what the players want to do, whether they want to interact or they want to act, and with whom they want to do this stuff, whether they want to act or interact with other players or they want to interact with the world. So if you have players that want to interact with the world, you have typically explorers. So you might say that kind of here you have Minecraft, kind of. Acting with other players is typically, this area is called killers, but it's basically because all the FPS shooting stuff is, multiplayer shooting stuff is here. You want to interact with other players, it could be Sims. Okay, and so the important part, achievers, is typically something between achievers and killers is something World of Warcraft here. So the point here is that you have to know what are your type of players. So if I want to do something that is, I want to attract these people, my game must be focus on these kind of players. It cannot address all the possible players. Okay? And to work on that, you can also work on the interactions about players, and you can say, okay, I have typically, typical interaction is single player versus game, so one player against the game. Otherwise, I have multiple players against the game, etc. And I can work on that. Unilateral competition is the most interesting one because it's the least used. It's one against a group of others. If you ever tried, you should really play Scotland Yard because it's the table version of unilateral competition. It's very, very nice. It's very, very nice. Splinter Cell, when you have one that is trying to enter some stuff and you have the team that is against them, that's kind of multilateral competitions. And obviously, so suppose that, just to make an example, suppose that you have a racing game, okay? A racing game like a racing game like a rally, okay? What is the most nice thing to do when you play rally games? Not F1, but rallies. You play against other players, or even Super Mario Kart for what it matters. You play against other players, you are with your car. What is something that you don't do in F1 but you would do in Mario Kart? What's that? Drifts, what do you mean? Well, yes. What's that? Yes, you can sportellate, as I say in Italian, and boom, put another one around, hit other cars, which you wouldn't do in F1. Now, this is the typical racing game. Do you want something special? Do you want to make something really, really special, something different? You check out what is the interaction. You say, I do something there. I do exactly another racing game. I took one of the elements and I destroy it. What happens? You have Trackmania. Trackmania is a very nice game, very successful. 16 people racing, but there is only one car. What happens? Suddenly, all the cars are there. The cars don't eat each other. Okay, so, technically speaking, it's like you are playing by yourself, but they are the others. Okay, they are the other's car. But if I play with another car and I hit it, I trespass them. So there is no dynamic about hitting cars, taking out one off-road and stuff. But I basically modified some stuff. And I actually gave a completely different gameplay to the players, okay? So, it's like I'm playing alone because I don't have any interaction with the others, but actually I don't feel alone because there are other cars running with me, racing with me, okay? So, this is a way to take one of those elements, modify it, and obtaining something that is completely, completely different. That's why you usually try to analyze the games, because otherwise, how do a new game comes from? Okay? There are a lot of definitions of games. Here I put something. One of the interesting, most cited definitions is the simpler one, a series of meaningful choices. What all these definitions don't tell you, it's how to engineer fun. How do you find fun? So, as I said, this is probably one of the most famous books in the field. And it's basically a book about defining fun. Where fun comes from? It's basically coming from our brain. And why our brain, when our brain perceives fun, it's happy. Okay? Well, typically, our brains look for patterns. So we are highly engineered machines to find patterns in stuff, extract those patterns, and reuse that pattern. So when I was a kid, I probably touched fire, it hurt me, and then I said, okay, I won't touch fire anymore. I extract the patterns that was there. And if now somebody says, Pier Luca, don't touch the fire, I said, yes, I know. So that information is useless for me. So the idea is that we find games really fun because they are typically They provide us with processed information that is very simple, just processed in small patterns, okay? Do you want to play Sudoku? Sudoku was a very interesting game until somebody says there is a strategy to win Sudoku. You can apply this algorithm and you always win and solve a Sudoku, okay? Why chess is still interesting? Because even if there are books on chess, you still feel that every match is different. There is not a dominant strategy, okay? So that's what makes it. So typically speaking, as I said, we are really, really, really good at finding patterns. I don't know whether you see the face, okay? So you immediately see these patterns. And if I show you, hey guys, this is the author of the book, you would say, yes, I can understand. I just have the intuition of that. And basically I see that it's a person. But actually if I feed you with stuff that where you don't find patterns, you become immediately distressed and you basically leave it, okay? So the point here is there is a balancing game. That is, I need to provide you patterns that your brain like, but I actually not, they must change often, otherwise you become bored immediately, like, don't touch the fire, don't touch the fire. The fire is bad, don't touch the fire. At the fourth time, I leave the game. And something that has no pattern at all. I play the game and I don't understand what I have to do to win. And that's the most worst stuff. But as soon as we find patterns, we are very happy. We are very happy. And basically our brain says, oh my God, that's very good. And it's all about dopamine. Okay, it's all about dopamine. So it's a chemical process, okay? And the feeling of winning is basically release endorphins, and that's what makes us feel good. Okay, so the fun in there, it's a chemical explanation, but actually also provides us with a way to engineer fun in a game. So you have to provide patterns. Patterns should be really, really, really different from time to time, but easy to digest, because as soon as we identify the patterns, we get bored, okay? So as soon as I understand how Sudoku works and I can win every time at Sudoku, I don't play Sudoku anymore. If I would have an algorithm to win every play in Razzle or to have a very good chance to win in Razzle, I wouldn't play Razzle anymore, okay? And so that's basically the most important part. Generally speaking, when you're playing and you're identifying games, what you want to do is to have rich interpretable situations. So you want games where you have many situations, because otherwise you don't go there and play. But actually every situation has a more and more interpretation. So it's rich as an interpretation. So I look at Sudoku is there, okay? I look at chess, I play chess, but every play is different. I go multiplayer, and that's why multiplayer games, they usually have a big success, because every match is completely different from any other match. There is no dominant strategy, okay? And it's very interesting, if you go online and you check out some games that in some levels they have a dominant strategy, like, suppose that you have in Battlefield, you can go in that level, you can go there with the sniper and you can, you know, kill everybody. All the people will be immediately pissed at the people who did the level design for that, because we don't like it. And so, for instance, we introduce something like this that start our curiosity, and that's one of the things that, for instance, in Mario is very famous. And also, since endorphins are given, one of the chemical release of endorphin is when you feel that you won in a very, very incredible way. You have McGonigal says that it's the fiero feeling, so you feel like, yes, I did it. That's why some games, they put exactly winning states that are amazing, you know. I don't know whether you play chess, but I don't really like the fact that chess, oh, you win, oh, yes. It's much better when you say, yes, I did it. So that's the way my endorphins are released. That's why sometimes you feel like some games, they have extremely winning state. Candy Crush Saga, exploits basically even the nastier way to show you that you are winning. I remember the first time I played Candy Crush Saga, and was the only one. I played, I made, I don't know, whether 3 lemons in a row, 3 candies in a row, whatever it was. I said, oh my God, what I do was, you know, it's, that's why they use it, because the feeling that you are winning, even from stupid stuff, you know, that's probably, at the, I was thinking, at the university, it would be really nice to say, you know, that if you even get an 18 degree, the minimum degree, then you have people cheering, yes, you did it. I wonder whether it would change your feeling about that. So I will. We have 1 minute left. I will show you just some of the tools, but it's a very simple stuff. So everybody in a game design, they have a book, a diary, where they, every time they have an idea, they've wrote it there, and they've wrote it physically. They don't write it with the computer, because when you do a sketch, it's much better. When you need inspiration, there are cards that helps you to find inspiration. So they have several ones, game seeds, VNA. And so the idea is that you shuffle the cards and you, like the E-King, if you have tried something like this. You go there, they are, I don't know, they give you some elements and they give you some stuff from which you could start. There are oblique strategies. This one is very famous. That's from the same book. And here, it basically tells you, for instance, you are looking at the game, you are stuck, and you want to analyze the game. You pick up some of the cards, and every card is a different lens you can watch your game. You can use to look at your game. One of the things is triangulation, which is, or triangularity, which is very important. So typically, in a game, I have to go from here to there. From here to there, I have a lot of enemies, so it's very difficult. So if I keep the games like this, if I'm not very good, they kill me, I go back. At the third time, I leave the game. So you use a triangularity strategy where players are provided by very good players, they go directly, kill the guys and go there. Otherwise, they have a triangle, so a different path that avoids the enemy, but it's a longer one. So if you feel very good, you go directly one side. Otherwise, you go and take the two sides. Use Lego and use whatever Apple helps to build it up. And just to be then I will show you a picture. One of the things is game design is basically interaction design. So you have to consider the player, and the most important part is fail early, fail often. So if you want to make a game now, and you plan to make a game or something that is game-ish, the most important part is to start with a rough sketch of the game and start it immediately to try. These are the example of the, all the tests that were done to make the mouse for the Mac, for the first Mac. You should prototype immediately, as soon as possible, even with something that is really weird. For the ones who played Kojima games, Metal Gear Solid Saga, the levels that you're playing electronically, they were made by, that's an original Kojima level made by Lego. And that's more or less this. My students, when they start with a game concept that is something like this. As you see, that's the idea. And it's very important to sketch the idea immediately. And then they ended after 1 month, 2 months, with this. Which was a very simple, this is the trailer of the game that they have to do. And this is the prototype of the game, that we are missing graphics and stuff like this. But that's the same game as it was implemented. A couple of months. If you want further reference, you can have a lot of books. You can have a lot of movies, or you can contact me. Thank you very much.